Okay, well, if you're here, you obviously know that this is the Linux User Group.
If you're here and you don't know that, welcome.
Yeah, welcome. We do have a website, and I'm not just a member, I'm the president still.
Dictator.
So if anyone does want to run for office, we'll have elections whenever we have candidates. Until then, welcome to Russia.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's not
really a joke. Yeah, we're only laughing because otherwise we'd be crying. So tonight we're at the wonderful DMAC Institute of Learning here. And thank you to our host for yet again letting us in the door.
Without having to call security.
Yeah. And tonight, Ken will be talking about baking raspberry pies, or something like that.
Baking raspberry pies,
or the janitor,
just know the
national display.
Of Jeff.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not easy.
So, yeah, I guess, take it away.
Take it away, okay.
Well, oh, looks like we've got one more person coming
it's
in.
It's going to be short and sweet, I think. And you know you can do it again and grab some food.
So, more questions now?
Sure. First of all, I am running what's the release? Raspbian, the latest version.
No.
Isn't that?
Because there's definitely one based on Scratch now.
Oh, there is? Okay, well,
yeah.
The previous latest version.
I haven't seen it in a while.
And this is pretty much bone stock, except for so. This version has the desktop auto login available. I think some previous versions did not, and so you had to do some other stuff to get the auto login to the user. But this one has that option. So you definitely want to desktop auto login. That's going to log you in as the Pi user. And then, what was the other one? Much else. Oh, expand without this, if you just image it. You might want to change the memory span, especially if you're doing a larger display than this. This one doesn't need much, but out of the box, this is only like 16 or 8. It's like really low.
Right.
And so if you're doing like a 1080p display, it chokes right up. So.
Does it have the capability of doing 4K or?
Some of them?
Some, maybe the newest ones?
Some of the higher end.
Yeah, but I don't think this works. No. 1080p is probably about as high as you want to get anyway. Did you want to save some memory for the stuff that you're going to display?
And it's too slow. Chromium will crash otherwise.
Yeah. And that's about it. I mean, you don't really need to change any of the other stuff unless you want to set up a bunch of those things. Overclocking, I didn't overclock it.
I have overclocked a
one of the little heat sinks on here, mm-hmm. Not the small ones, which help a little bit. Even with just the stock clock speed.
I did overclock a gaming Raspberry Pi. Not that it really helped or was all that noticeable, but
it was there.
Yeah. every version I had, Nintendo 64 still was not very well handled.
That's pretty bad. So I used this guy's guide. It might not show up very well on this screen. For the most part, I stuck with this one, guys. But I did change up a little bit. So he was doing a kiosk for a recording studio. It's not really a recording studio, a kiosk necessarily. It was an informational display. He was basically trying to update the recording studio schedules for all the different rooms in the lobby so that when recording artists came in, they could glance at the screen and see where their scheduled time slot was. So, you definitely want Chromium. You want X11 server utils, because that's partially how you will stop the screen from lighting all the time. And then Unclutter, I used a different thing than Unclutter. He uses Unclutter to hide the mouse pointer, because when it boots up, this is supposed to be kind of like a hands-free, you don't touch it. If it reboots or you reboot it, power cycle it, you don't have to do anything to it. It just loads all the tabs that you want and all the stuff, and you make the mouse disappear. But there's a problem with Unclutter, as you will see. So basically the mouse pointer is there, you can see it moving around. Out of the box, Unclutter will, if you let go for a second, make that just disappear. The problem is, if you're hovered over something, it will activate that. So something that has like a pop-up, or see how that changes color on the scroll bar? Anything that activates like a drop-down kind of menu, would see like that right there. Script save. If the mouse pointer will disappear, but that little pop down won't. And what you find is when you come out of the boot into the full screen, if your website has something like right here that pops something down, that will always be there if you just use Unclutter. So what I used was a different utility that actually moves the mouse to the far corner.
Put it in the corner.
Yep, throw it into the corner. I still use Unclutter, because then you won't see the little pen pop down there. It does make that disappear, which you can't really see it here either. But sometimes on some displays, you can actually see it kind of there, but it'll totally disappear as well. So I use both. And, this is reloading the tabs because I'm not happy with it. Which I'll go over later. So those are the main packages, and I'll get to that other package a little bit later. It's another package you have to install. And he has setting up SSH, which you can do, and network, which you should probably do if you want it to connect to your network out of the box.
Do you have some good tab manager?
This is going to be a tab reloader. And a tab switcher. Networking, yeah. So, you know, at home I have wireless. So it would look, I need to do that. So, sample config here. You would set up WPA supplicant and then networking? No, let's see. I can never remember where that is.
Network?
Is it just network? Yeah, so that's where you associate WN0 with. But you get the idea. You need to set up your networking so that it connects automatically. Well, actually, this remembered. Connected that after a reboot, it didn't. It? Cool. So maybe I didn't need to do that.
Okay.
So I'm logged in as the user PI. By default, this uses the LXDE.
Stuff.
So the way you can get to auto start things is not too big. LX session and LX pod. And that has changed in different versions. That LX pi part. It was called something else in the previous version. I think in this guy's write up, he actually says at the bottom that it's now pi. He did like an update.
Right.
Oh, that was a different thing that changed. Wait. You go in here and you got auto start. Out of the box, it looks something like that. Where we want to get to is here. A lot of stuff there. So this stuff right here. The X set stuff specifically is what turns off the power management right here, because out of the box, the Pi, I think after like 20 minutes or so, will go to sleep, like completely blank the screen, no matter what's going on with the OS or anything. If you're idle, it will completely blank the screen. So these two actually, I believe, take care of that. I can't remember what that one does. I think it's related. And then you've got your Chromium browser with all your tabs. So you actually have to specify which tabs you want to open on this command line, which, as you can see, can get ugly if you have some big old URLs. I'm only loading a few tabs. The more tabs you load, the worse off you'll probably be, because you're using more resources. And yeah. And I have found even with these tabs that I have, one of them has a memory leak of some sort, because after a while, it really bogs down. Mm-hmm. So the solution to that? Chrome tab, a reboot every 2 hours. Problem solved.
Let's see, switching.
Yeah. I also play some music, because why not? I set up a similar system at work in our break room, so it's kind of like a music phone before our break. And then here's the XPO tool. That's the one that you have to install. And I think it's, the package is just XPO tool, yep, right there. That's the name of the package, actually. So that's the one that does the mouse move after everything else is loaded. And I just did 10,000, 10,000, which is crazy insane, but you could find it by the Plex. That pretty much guarantees, even if it's a pretty big display, that it'll go all the way down and go all right.
The S off is disabled screen saver blinking.
Mm-hmm.
And DPMS is turn off DPMS.
Okay. And then X set no blink? What does that do? I can't remember.
Oh, it's not blinking the screen, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because one's killing the screen saver.
Yeah, and one's doing the power screen.
Yes.
Okay, gotcha. So I'm going to CPU that to auto start. And then this should actually reboot it into the actual kiosk thing. Now, I don't think we have audio, do we?
Maybe.
In this thing?
It looks like there's a little one. I'm not going to make any bets on how bad it sounds.
Yeah. So I believe my mouse is actually already. Oh, hey! Group salad. So it was a weather service. It was more weather service. It loves more weather service. I like watching one. It loves headlines and news, so. That's about it. Pretty simple. At work, I do. This time of year, I've been doing the Iowa 4511 road conditions, the simple version of it, not the complex one. The static picture that reloads every now and then. And then I do like our front page of our website. Why not? And what else do I mean? We put a couple of weather service pages just to show the weather. And then I think I have our Google Analytics page that shows how many people are visiting our site in sort of somewhat real time so that people can see how busy things are. And oh, there's like an internal site that news. Intro web or whatever you want to call it, site that it's basically a WordPress site that HR posts and stuff to. And they are for announcements and stuff on there. So that's that. Mouse pointer is not going away because I neglected to actually turn on unclutter, which I can do.
What does pros on your Raspberry Pi then?
It's the Raspbian.
Raspbian.
Yeah, and evidently it's a little old.
They look a little retro. Well, that's a whole different operating system.
Retro. Retro Pi. Okay.
So here, if you change start unclutter to true, this boots really fast too.
What kind of CPU is in that thing?
It's a Pi 3. I can't remember which.
So you can play 1.4?
I think so. It's definitely high. So now the mouse pointer is disappeared.
Faster than
the old ones, yeah. So here's the mouse pointer, and it should disappear after a second. There it goes. But if you go to like here, or no, Where was it?
Down there.
Oh, there it was, yeah. The mouse printer goes away, the little pop-up logo thingy doesn't. That's why you move the mouse. Because that would be annoying.
Well, auto change the screen, so it won't matter.
Well, it moves on to the next thing, but as soon as it comes back to this page, that's going to pop back up.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Or if it's like on here, and you get that. I mean, when you first boot up, if you don't move the mouse is in somewhere in this general area right here, by default, if you don't move it. So, on just about every page that you bring up, there's something there that pops up a little thing. And, yeah, I think I've got 42 seconds on my app over here.
He does have a command that runs, but since he's moving around the mouse, it overrides.
Yeah, it only moves at boot. It doesn't move it any time after that. So if I go to here, config, that session, this one down here, the XDO tool,
is where that's the mouse over here.
Yep. And that only runs once after it boots. And shoves the mouse down in the corner, it doesn't keep running and keep. That would be annoying. If you were trying to do anything.
You could put a cron tab on it, couldn't you?
Yeah, you could. Every minute.
It would be how people kept their screen from working.
Unless you bought one of those USB mouse.
Yeah, there's the reboot right there. Every 2 hours. Which is commented out at the moment, but just when you're working on it, and all of a sudden it's on you, you're like, oh crap.
I didn't save that.
I forgot. Yeah. Let's disable that. And the time is somewhat accurate. So yeah, every 2 hours at 8 o'clock to reboot.
Didn't go up the MPP. Can I have someone to make sure the time was on time?
Who's a perfectionist in there?
It's getting there. It's been off for a while, so that's probably why it's not exactly right. It's probably off by enough that it won't.
You could run NTP
date. Not with NTP services, right?
No. You not be supposed to, but I haven't gotten away with it. Find out apple.com for you.
Third. Escalate. Yeah, you can talk in as a name step. So you have the
kill.
I can't complete that.
I didn't see it.
And there we go. And now it's a little more accurate. But yeah, if it's been powered off for a while, it kind of just loses the time. And there's no real hardware clock on the Pi. In fact, there's a fake hardware clock service. So that it doesn't really freak out, but there's no hardware clock.
So what you're saying is you shouldn't run this as your NTP server for your house.
No, you should not. In fact, I think you can see it here.
So you just let it run, will it eventually correct it for
if you've
you
got
to stop clock as well as NTP, twice a day.
If you've got NTP servers running, you can eventually time a server.
Eventually it'll fix it.
Well,
depends on
depends on how far off it is, too. If the time is off by too much, it won't actually correct it. It's like, whoa!
That stuff's interesting.
Yeah. So you might have to, if it's been turned off for a while, You might have to set the time manually to get close, and then MCPD can get back on track.
Where was that?
I've seen sometimes in, it's kind of a little bit inky, but in scripts, sometimes it will run NDP date first.
Yeah.
Get the clock set.
To get it.
And then run the NDP service to
keep it
yep. going. Okay. Or search for or the client.
Yeah, I know.
I've also seen people just run NDP date on the ground jump run. Bam!
So we demoed that. And we talked about the cron reboot because, yeah, if you have leaky memory gaps. Oh, let's go over the... Actually, I know, I came out of this on purpose. So... Okay, one of the things that you might have missed in this big jumbled mess here of URLs is this right there. So kiosk is a special mode in Chromium that launches it full screen, but it locks in that mode too.
Ah.
So that's why I had to actually kill all the tabs to get out of the browser. Because you can't bring it back to normal screen size when it's in kiosk mode. You actually have to just kill it. And then I can go back up here and launch the browser again. You can't even bump the top like you can in full screen mode and get the tabs to drop down. It's in kiosk mode.
Right.
So here I've got the one last thing is the revolver tabs plugin thingy. So what that does, and there's all kinds.
If the kiosk mode did that built in.
No.
You're using this.
I'm using a plugin. Yeah, and there's tons of different plugins. I just chose this one. There's lots of different ones that have different features. I kind of like this one because it also has an option to reload the tab. So every time you switch tabs, it reloads that tab too. That way it keeps it refreshed. On the downside, it's reloading every tab every 42 seconds, which is kind of stupid. What you could use is a combination of this with a tab reloader type separate app that reloads tabs. And then that way, this one's not reloading every time it switches tabs, but the tab reloader can have maybe more of the same type reload interval. Like the National Weather Service has an update every 42 seconds, so there's really no reason to refresh them every 42 seconds. So it would make more sense to have like a 5 minute, with weather service, I found that like 15 minutes or so is a good refresh for them.
That'd be correct. That's good.
15 to 17 ish.
Yes. Yeah.
Minutes is a good refresh for them.
A lot of times the weather wire.
But I'm being a jerk and I'm refreshing them 42 seconds. Well, it's not 42 seconds exactly because it has to go through. So it's 42 times the number of tabs that I have. So. It's a little bit less than every 42 seconds, but
yeah.
It's still way more than it needs to be. And of course, it has the auto start when the browser starts.
And the amount of risk you have is that if you do it days after days after days, someone might finally
blacklist me.
You.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought about that too. So I should probably rethink the combination. The key part is you need a plugin that you can set, and those settings will stick, so that you know you don't have to set them up every single time.
How about localhost with split or something?
You could do that, yeah.
That'd be that low, and it'd get moderate pretty low, it'd kind of convoluted.
But then it would hit the cache every time instead of getting the external site.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Only pull whatever
they have advertised for cash timeout.
Yep. And that way, we hammer your cash instead of hammering them. That's a good idea.
I'm betting that my
firewall probably does it a little bit.
A better Raspberry Pi probably has a CPU to run Squid too.
Probably. Do the local proxy
straight line.
Yeah, and the pinch you could probably just run it local.
I just started and I did an SSH tunnel on the local.
And then I got more script saved on the whole app or stuff, but I really don't need it for what this is doing. But yeah, there's different combinations of plugins you can get, but that's what I'm using to switch the panels. The key again is that it needs to be able to auto start and not require any post start configuration, because as soon as you reboot, you don't want to be messing around with it. It remembers the body.
That's good. It's going to stay a little bit.
I don't know if it would save it when you unplug it. Or if it saved it to the charger now.
Let's do that after it's got that. It is remembering the wireless. That does come up if you reboot when the browser's running. But it does disappear after a little while. So it's annoying, but not super annoying. One way that people suggest getting around that is to use the incognito mode. But then certain things aren't going to persist. Like, for example, I mentioned at work we're bringing up our Google Analytics page. Mm-hmm. We need to use the cache to log in for the Google Analytics page to log into it. Mm-hmm. So we're loading that as a tab after you've already logged into it. Non-incognito mode remembers that. If we were using incognito mode, it wouldn't. And so then we'd be like, oh, we gotta log in. We've got a reasonable time to reboot this thing. And of course, I've got crontab a little more complicated on the one at work, so that it only starts up in the morning, runs the tab stuff all day long, and then a little bit after, I think I've got mine a little later now at 4:30 or 5:30, 6 o'clock, just in case it was like weather and people wanted to see it. Then I have it go into kind of what I would call a lower power state. I kill X Windows, I kill, you know, it kind of goes back down to like just a command prompt only kind of screen. But I also have the monitor itself turn itself off, because it's got a timer and schedule too. So I can order things with the crontab of the Pi, with the timers on the display, so that the display turns on a little bit after this thing is booted up. And this thing goes to sleep. Not really sleep, but it's more in a low power state. All the processes are stopped except like the bare minimum. And then the monitor goes off a little bit before that happens. And then the Chrome tab will just reboot this in the morning, shortly before the display wakes back up. Because Chrome is still running in that state, but there's nothing showing on the screen. It's not using a lot of resources. It's not really a power save mode, but it's in a lower power state because it's just not doing much.
Isn't there actually a power save mode?
And I think I actually disabled my tab filter because I should have looked for that. That's one thing about it, is you've got to make sure this tab filter is actually active when you pull the plug.
Yes, there is a sleep mode, but you may or may not actually have Chrome running.
You won't have Chrome tab, so if you put it in sleep, power save. So then you need some sort of external method of power cycling it.
Do a wake on lamp.
Yeah.
My advisor wants four.
Wireless wake on lamp.
I thought there was a wake on W lamp.
You just set up the microwave next to it.
Now you were saying.
person wants to be asking, like, is going to be infrared tumor, like the detect sort of
like a motion sensor?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that
we turn it on
it
and off.
Has its own timeout. There's not a quick kiosk, that could be in Bash, it could be in Python, it could be Carmen Water.
One of these the motion sensor for
a timer, a countdown timer, if it has not been triggered, stay on for a half hour or something, and then it still hasn't been shut down. What kind of screen is this working?
Just like a big screen.
LCD?
Yeah, LCD type display.
What, via HDMI?
It's like a 50 inch or something on the wall.
HDMI. Okay, so HDMI CEC is in mainline kernel now. I don't know if it's made it to Raspbian and their distro, but it's all theoretically possible. So that you can send your CEC commands across HDMI to turn on and off and whatever else, but in this case, you just want of that screen.
You so when
you know what a screen for CEC commands I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. Okay. So
what you're saying is when the
HDMI
monitor turns
in
itself.
It has its own, even the original 1.0 protocol has in the protocol so that you could have devices, you know, black video players, DVD players, TV
turns on,
audio, etc. Well, have you ever connected those together and then had one of them turn the other on? You turn a source and it turns, well, it sends a signal. They have a small serial data link before they even started adding
it. Hey,
it powers up onto HDMI. You can send commands on and off and change channel and volume up and down and all and numbers and all sorts of whatever HDMI. And the control for that used to be an out of tree and a combination of user source and this driver. It's in the main room now. There's a user space.
So you could have the monitor control when this turns on.
You can have it control
the
monitor.
Okay.
So yeah, and the ultimate idea would be so the timer, motion detector hasn't been, hopefully motion detector is connected up to the one of the 40 or a couple of the 40 pins.
Yeah.
What do you call those? IO pins?
GPIO.
GPIO pins?
Yep.
And nobody's been by. Send the command to turn TV/monitor off for HDMI and shut down into a low power state. Cross fingers, there should be some sort of low power state that still is talking to GPIO. Because some of those GPIO pins can wake the thing up. I don't know which one.
There is the pathological case that you could have something else, a smaller control board that is hooked up to the thing, and it just sends you could send a pulse down the GPIO pin and just be listening for it, and when you see it, start the shutdown process, because you know you have 10 seconds till the other thing shuts off the power for the whole system.
There we go. Now it's...
And just reboot it every time someone comes walking by.
Then the idea is that when it does get triggered, someone comes walking by, that it, is this brand new? Then wake the machine, wake everything up. If it's not, reset the counter.
And then also a warrant. And I haven't figured this part out either. I'm kind of stuck at old school as far as presentation. Not PowerPoint, impress, whatever. slideshow.
Yeah.
But I want my data. And everybody's building with them web pages now. Mm-hmm. So I want one, I want a stack.
That would be the easiest way to use it. So there's the power, remove.
Even if your web page is literally just instead of giving a picture.
He has a group push.
I'm the old man now. I don't like how everything's
on. I mean,
web.
You could do the whole thing as just one web page that you visit. And it does all the switching for you between the various things.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of having multiple tabs, you just load the one tab to the one web server that serves up your content. And then you can program that any way you want.
You could have a local node instance running, I'm assuming they run
on it. It's in JavaScript.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can do that too.
Or if you run Apache, you could do it in PHP. Tomcat Java, .NET runs now.
Yes, I'm looking. You said there was a thing to remove the...
Yeah, the historic features thing. So whenever Chrome shuts down Battery, it saves its state on a certain file.
So you remove that file?
Well, I'm going to remove the file because it's like a preferences type file.
Oh.
But if you said, replace, failed with success or whatever, like,
yeah,
you get through that.
Cool.
Actually, it went away pretty quick.
It does as soon as the tab switches.
Oh, there you go. So
the problem why it wasn't going away before was because the tab wasn't switching. Because earlier I had turned off my tab switcher, and then when I rebooted, it was
still
in off state. Yes. And then for some reason I was having trouble getting it started back up again, and that's why I've been fiddling with it. Now it's doing the 42 second thing. But yeah, it only shows up on that first tab when you first reboot up. So yeah, that's kind of why I was like, no biggie. Yeah, and on the tabs that I'm loading here, I could totally use Incognito because I'm not logging in to any of these pages. At work, I'm logging into a couple of those pages, so I kind of can't use that Incognito.
Yep.
Chromium is the only browser that's on.
I think so.
Sorry. Chromium is an older browser.
The
Chromium version is an older version on this Raspbian model.
Yeah.
So
but you can't get, there are newer ones up there if you look through the repository. The problem is that there are a whole bunch of different old versions. So finding ones that work well would be tricky.
Do like a disk upgrade or whatever?
Yeah, you should be able to.
Use that awesome Wi-Fi that is just upgraded? Oh, yeah. VLC is installed. That's how I'm doing music. By the way, I'm using the CVLC, which is the command line, so it doesn't launch the actual GUI. Anyway.
That's a great example. If I wanted to have video,
30 seconds. It shows up
as we need that accelerate, quote unquote hardware accelerate, on something as
I'm using the CVLC.
Stunted as a pie. So I need a real compiled application instead of something inside the browser
So sudo, so you just want to do the update,
It's secure, right, John? Secure, correct?
What could happen?
What could possibly go wrong?
Worst case, you blow away the SD card and start.
We're having trouble already, anyway.
It's probably IP.
Yeah, use dash four.
Oh, wireless here.
Sometimes programs will, it's a little like maybe six. Well, there's going to be some option for it.
Yes, there is. It's in the apt-get Etsy folder. If you create a file in apt.conf.dd and put in the, it's like 99 force IPv4, and then put in there acquire :: force IPv4 true. Here.
You hold it, right?
You hold it.
99 force IPv4.
Yeah. Probably have to have a sudo on the front of time.
Yeah, probably. It looks like
it. Yeah, it looks like it. Yep.
There you go.
I've run into CenturyLink having a bad IPv6-ish stuff sometimes. It got no better than they once were.
How the hell does that do that?
This is
how today says IPv4. I guess I've never mastered the app.conf.
Forces it over to IP, using the IPv4 DNS. It took me a lot of searching, and I knew what I was looking for because I've had to do it at home.
I keep forgetting students.
I got to dig for it.
I updated this last night, so it doesn't have a documentation.
It's still on the network.
Where's their critics have to get this signed?
Does it say just
do you have this? Don't you have to change some other stuff, though, or do you just do this up?
Could you cap it out for the verification?
Some of them will just go.
That sounds like a classic case of stuff that really messed with your head, is something like that. Like 6 and 4.
Yeah, it looks like the easy way of updating is you have to go into your app list and change the names of the.
I think you need to change the.
It's going to take forever.
Yeah, that's not something you want to do. Demo real time.
Why not?
Well, you can.
Why not? It might work.
It's security. Yeah.
Work. It might surprise you.
It's just like FDisk can be surprising.
You can't do
the thing. There you go.
is a baby. Dude, Mike Moe. He grabs our ass. We're holding on there.
Why not?
It's not important much at all, but I won't even see. You won't be able to serve ads.
Yeah. Wow. That's not working, is it?
Weird.
Light mode sucks.
Yeah. It's light.
Never heard of light mode.
You could create a thing in. Yeah, there you go.
Dang, now you're totally. Not only after Jesus, it's great to tell the other.
Yeah, after Jesus, that might work.
So for next month, provided that Chris Rhodes is back from his adventure with the Sawbones, he'll be presenting on the worst proxy stuff, as well as some sort of demo of his company's remote access stuff, which may or may not actually really be source, but whatever. And we may or may not be here on site at DMAC, depending on what answer I get back from a couple of other places that would be more agreeable to him providing pizza as well for stuff. Because I'm pretty sure DMAC would be unhappy about pizza in a So, and I'll try and give more notice than the day before, like this month. Sorry about that. Mi culpa.
What? No, I picked it up in there.
Is it signed? People only pay attention to one part of it.
Yeah.
Go to Proc for a second.